So the last one is, why is there something rather than nothing?
Because God created it.
Who created God?
Nobody.
So God was just, I mean, I feel sorry for God because he's like, you know, I don't know where I came from.
He didn't come from anywhere. It's a wrong question.
So God just happened to look around and he always saw himself existing.
Not happened to look around, because if he always saw himself existing, there wouldn't be a point where he happened to look around to see if that were the case.
Well, you know, God tries to, I think there's kind of a comedy routine in here where God tries to figure out like, okay, I'm really going to figure it out this time. Where was I? I'm going to trace this all back. Where was I the day before that? Okay, I got that. Where was I the day before that? Dang it. I'm going back eternally. I can't find my beginning. I don't know how I got here.
Do you know, he does know how he got here. He's eternal. There is no I got here, which means
so he's like,
that there was a time when he wasn't there, which is not what the Christian theology teaches.
So he's like a lucky guy. He's like, how lucky,
lucky
am I?
Lucky guy?
Yeah, I'm a lucky guy. Oh, okay. I found myself eternally existing. I have no idea how I got to be eternally
how
existing.
How do you know he doesn't know how he's eternally existing?
Because he didn't make himself. He has no idea how he got there.
How do you know he doesn't have any idea about that?
How would he? He didn't make himself.
But
how,
you don't know. You're speaking for God now. He wouldn't know about this. How do you know?
Because he didn't create himself.
You're right. Good. I'm glad you agree. He didn't create himself. Psalm 90, verse 2.
So how would he know?
He told us. That's how we know. He
no,
told
no,
us. He
no.
Knows
how
about
would
himself.
He? How would he himself know?
I don't know how he would know. I don't have the privilege into the mind and thinking of God. Do you know what an actual infinite is versus a potential infinite?
I think so.
An actual infinite. For example, we take a yardstick. How many? 2 points. A yard. You know, a foot. Doesn't matter. How many points are on that line? An infinite number.
No, actually, there's a with Planck distance, there's an actual finite number, isn't there?
They go to 10 to the 40th. A point is not a dimension, it's a location.
No, but I mean, there's a Planck time and a Planck length, and the Planck length is the smallest possible.
Right.
So
a point has no dimensionality, therefore it has no length.
No, not a point. I'm just saying there is an actual length. It's a Planck length.
I got you.
It's
but we're
not,
not
a
talking
point.
About that. We're
it's
talking
not
about
a point.
Points.
What?
We're talking about points, not lengths. A point is a location.
No, I thought you said if you have 2 points, A and B, and you divide it up, how many divisions can you get? Is it infinite?
How many points are on a line? There's an infinite number.
Okay. That's different than asking if you can divide it up, right?
No. And if you take half that line, how many points are on that line? An infinite number.
Yeah, points because points don't have any dimension.
That's what I was saying. So how can half of the line be an infinite number that's equal to the whole of the line? This is a problem. It's a paradox, and it tries to demonstrate that there are no such things as actual infinites. It's like saying a set of dominoes are falling. I use this in my debate against Eddie Tabosh here in Boise State about 5 years ago. An infinite number of dominoes are falling. A line is infinitely long, left and right. We're standing there, we hear as the dominoes go by. We get in our super fast spaceship, and we go down to try and find the beginning. Well, because it's infinitely long, we're never going to find it.
Mm-hmm.
But that means there's no first domino.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Which means there's no second, no third, no fourth, no fifth.
Right.
There's no sequence that could ever be started.
Right.
This is a problem that we have when we look at things from our perspective.
Right.
What you're doing is you're saying, well, how did God have a beginning? Now you're saying, where's the first domino in an infinitely long thing? There can't be one.
Right. And that's what I'm saying. The poor guy, you know, God, that poor fella,
come on now.
He stays up at night trying to think, how did I come? How,
come on,
how,
come on, come on, come on.
Where did I come from? I don't know. I don't know where I came from. I just, every time I look around, I'm always there.
Okay.
I don't even know how I came to be here. I don't know why it's me instead of Charlie. I
now you're
these
being
other
demeaning
things.
And insulting.
How? No, seriously, he doesn't
know.
No,
you're saying poor God, he stays up at night not knowing what's going on?
Yeah, the poor fella, I mean,
okay.
I know where I came from,
right.
But
okay.
This poor fella doesn't know where he came from.
Well, if you're going to demean the conversation to that level, well, then we're not going to have a conversation.
Okay, I just kind of think there's a comedy routine in there somewhere.
Trust me, there's not. Maybe in the future. Without misrepresenting what it is the Christian theological position is.
Well, it's just like God's the lucky one who found himself eternally existing. It could have been anybody. It could have been you, but it was God. It was Yahweh who found himself eternally existing.
It could not have been me because he created me. By definition, mm-hmm. It could not have been me.
So, I mean, somehow, And then that's another strange thing. I mean, there's three of them, though, somehow, too?
Wait a minute. We're talking about God's creation. Why is there something rather than nothing? Not what the doctrine of the Trinity is. Why is there something rather than nothing? Because we exist because God created us to exist. You can't explain how things came into... Let me ask you a question. Do you know what a disjunctive syllogism is?
I know what a syllogism is. I'm not sure what a disjunctive one is.
Okay. A disjunctive syllogism says that when you only have two possibilities to account for something and one is negated, the other is validated.
Okay, I agree with you.
So we have, for example, God and not God.
Sure.
So if one of those is negated as a possible explanation for something, the other one must be valid because you can't negate both.
I could agree with that.
Disjunctive syllogism. Mm-hmm. So we have a personal cause of the universe or an impersonal cause of the universe.
Okay.
There are no other options.
Okay.
An impersonal cause of the universe would have to possess what's called the necessary sufficient conditions. In other words, all the parts necessary to bring creation into existence, bring the universe into existence.
Okay.
But not only that, it had to be sufficiently powerful, let's just say. Uh-huh. But the problem is that if it's necessary and sufficient and it possesses it, it'll possess it by nature.
Sure.
For however long it exists.
Okay.
But if it existed before the universe, we can go back to an infinite regression of what caused that, and we have the infinite regression problem, which you already discussed.
Right.
So functionally, we can just say, well, what brought into existence the universe? This thing, this substance, whatever it was.
Right.
But if it was that way, it would have to possess its nature eternally. It would have to have already been. It couldn't have come into existence. Then you've got the problem of an infinite regression.
Okay.
But if it possessed these things naturally, in the necessary sufficient conditions, then the result would have been automatic. It would have created a universe an infinitely long time ago. But the universe is not infinitely old.
Wait a second, though. I mean, there could be the creation of the Big Bang, which...
Beginning?
Wait, and physicists don't agree that that was the beginning of time, but let's say, for example, that's the beginning of time, so there was something outside of that that created it. It could still
exactly.
Be, but it could still be a multiverse or something.
Well, then where do the multiverses come from? And this is something
that
people are just theorizing that they don't know about.
Of course, yeah, it's all theory. Nobody knows anything. Nobody knows the answer.
But we do know, logically, that whatever brought the universe into existence had to precede it and had to have the ability to do that. It had to have the necessary sufficient conditions.
Right, I agree.
But if it's impersonal, it had to have those conditions eternally. If it had it eternally, it would have brought it into existence. But the universe is not infinitely old. Mm. Therefore, the impersonal cause of the universe cannot work. And the other view has to be validated. There's a personal cause of the universe.
It seems like you're making a jump there to a personal being.
It's a disjunctive syllogism, which you agreed with.
I think something got lost in the translation there.
Well, we're about out of time.
Yeah,
I'm trying to get it out quickly here. What do you want?
We can discuss
it slowly at a later time.
Yeah. We only got 40 seconds now. So.
See? Okay.
Okay, so I'll let you summarize, and then we're going to have to say goodbye on this one.
Okay. Real simple. An impersonal cause of the universe cannot work logically. The only other option is a personal cause, because you can't have an impersonal cause of the universe be in place. I can explain it again another time when we have more time.
Yeah, I mean, you know, one thing I've learned from this show with you is that there's no way we can do these topics. I was just trying to hope to get some kind of, I don't know, it's like we're not even scratching the surface on 10 minutes on these subjects.
That's right. So. I do this a lot, so it takes time.
Okay, well, I appreciate the call and all that, so thanks for participating.
Sure, no problem, man. Give me a call again, we'll do it again, okay?
Okay, sounds like fun. All right, take care.
Thanks.
Goodbye. Okay.